Thank you. heart of mine, this heart of mine, this heart of mine, this heart of mine.
From the rock comes forth.
soul.
The floods are raging. Your presence is like fire.
presence, Lord. And your word is like a fire burning me. Lord, your word is like a fire burning me. Lord, your word is like a fire.
In my soul, burn, 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 burn,
in my soul, burn, 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 in my soul. For our God is a consuming fire. 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 Lift your voice in a shout of praise. Lift your voice in a shout of praise. Oh, let the voice of triumph shout. Let the shout break out. Let the shout, oh, the shouts of God, oh, the shouts of authority, oh, the shouts of His word proclaimed in the earth. Yes, 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 Jesus, 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 Lord. Himself mighty on their behalf. He's looking for the mighty. He's looking for someone he can make valiant. He's looking for the valiant. Those who run through a troop and leap over every wall. The valiant. Make us valiant for you, Lord. Make us a valuer. Make us valiant. Good soldier. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. Have your way in us, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Have your way in us. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Have your way. Jesus, 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 have your way in us. Jesus, 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 have your way in us. Have your way in us, Lord. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Lord Jesus, have your way. You will, oh God, you will, oh God, your way, oh Lord, your way, oh God. Your name. above the heavens. Your name is exalted above all things. Your name is exalted above the heavens. Your name is exalted above all things. The Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run and are safe. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run and are safe forevermore. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run and are safe. Refuge, Lord, you're a refuge and strength. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run and are safe. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run and are safe. The Lord is a strong tower, the righteous running and are safe. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous running and are safe. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous running and are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous running and are saved. So let the dancing begin, let the joy now begin, for the Holy One, the Lord who's our friend. He's called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Oh, you called us out of darkness into your marvelous light, so we can show forth your praises. We can show forth your praises, Lord. the presence of the Lord and tremble at the presence of the Lord. We tremble, Lord, at the presence of the Lord. We tremble, Lord, at the presence of the Lord. We tremble, Lord, at the presence of the Lord. Presence of your God, Maker of the heavens, Creator of the earth, you're the Maker of the heavens, Creator of the earth, you're the Maker. Of the Lord, tremble, Lord, at the presence of your God. Tremble, Lord, at the presence of the Lord. Tremble, Lord, at the presence of the Lord. Lord, we tremble. Lord, we tremble at your word. Lord, we tremble at your presence. The presence of the Lord, we tremble, oh earth, at the presence of your God. We tremble, oh earth, at the presence of the Lord. We tremble, oh earth, at the presence of your God. We tremble, oh, at the presence of the Lord. For holy is Lord. For holy is Lord. And sacred is his presence. Thank you. exalted, risen King, clothed in majesty, all your works they see of the glory of your name, and praise you, they praise you, we praise you, we praise you. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King.
Sing and say. For all
glory, honor, and praise. All power, might, and dominion to you, Lord, King of kings, King of kings, and Lord of lords, majesty. The glory of the Lord. 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 As the water covers the earth. As the water covers the earth. Oh, show your glory, God. The earth will be filled. The earth will be filled once again with the knowledge of the Lord. Oh, the knowledge of the Lord. The knowledge of Yehovah. The knowledge of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. We rejoice in you, our salvation, Lord. We rejoice in you, our salvation. You fill our mouths with laughter and our tongues with singing. You fill our mouths with laughter and our tongues with singing. The songs of praise, the song of the Lord, the song of the redeemed. With praise we enter in your court. With praise we draw near to you, Lord. Thank you. cover this whole earth. As the waters cover the sea, Lord, let your glory cover this whole earth. As the waters cover the sea again, let your glory cover this earth. In 2016, Lord, as the waters cover the sea, oh, let your glory cover this earth. As the waters cover the sea, Lord, let your glory cover this earth. As the waters cover the sea, Lord, let your glory cover this earth. As the waters cover the sea. But it starts with us, you and me, me and you, showing forth the praises of the Almighty. You and me, me and you, lit up with the glory glow of heaven. Oh, it starts with you, it starts with me, being witnesses and ambassadors of Christ Jesus in this earth, speaking forth his word, living by his word, to show forth his praises, because we're living by his word, as he ordains our steps, as we acknowledge him in all our ways, and he directs our paths, and leads us in the ways we ought to go, and leads us in the ways everlasting. Lead us in the way, Lord. Lead us in the way. We hold nothing back from you. No, 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 not nothing. Not one small thing, Lord. Nothing back from you, Lord. We hold nothing back. Say it, Lord, we hold nothing back. Lord, we hold nothing back. Lord, we hold nothing back from you, oh Lord. Oh, then the glory of the Lord invades our life and fills us with the knowledge of him and every good thing, and that our works are ordained under praise and honor and glory, ordained by the Almighty, ordained by the Holy One, oh, most Holy One. We hold nothing back from you, but we hold nothing back from you. We hold nothing back from you, Lord. We hold nothing back from you. In your mercy, show us your glory. Show us your glory, Lord. Deeper than anything we've ever seen. Deeper than anything we've ever known. Blow our minds, God. Invade every part, Lord. Jesus, oh Jesus, we love you, we love you, Lord, with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our lives, with everything we are, oh God, with everything we have. We will follow after you, Lord, with our everything, no matter what the cost, no matter what the cost, Lord. Glory will cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. Oh, yes, your glory will cover this earth as the waters cover this. Yes, your glory will cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. Yes, your glory will cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. Yes, your glory will cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. Let your glory cover this earth as the waters cover the sea. In this year 2016, Father, in this year 2016, Lord, even now, even now, even now, oh Lord, yes, your glory will cover this earth as the water covers the sea. Yes, your glory will cover this earth as the water covers the sea, Lord.
Image. Father, not in what I think or perceive or what man would say, but Father, what you say by your Spirit. Father, I will allow myself to be led and guided by your precious Holy Spirit continually, Lord. So by your holiness and your righteousness will I seek. Who you are, I will seek. Lord, I will allow your glory to change me from glory to glory to glory to glory to glory to glory. In your image and your likeness, form me and fashion me, Father. Father, in this perfect work that you have done through the salvation of your Son, Jesus Christ, in me, conforming me into the image and the likeness of your dear Son through his blood that he shed on Calvary. Lord Jesus, I surrender myself. Father, I surrender myself to you. In this new life, to be given over to you and you alone. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. You alone, oh God. You alone, oh God. Not allowing the distractions of this earth. Father, putting them aside. People, we want to put aside those things that distract us. We want to get on our face like never before. And we've been on a fast and a prayer time, just seeking the Lord, separating ourselves unto God. But it's not just now, it's just the beginning of a continuation that we go on and seek the Lord. If we continue on to know the Lord, if we continue on to go know the Lord, Hosea says, then we can look at that. Hosea, Bolebishukora, Zelenda, Borasita. Oh, hallelujah. Father, when we become broken and humble and contrite before the Lord, and we allow him to have all of us, all of our words, all the words of our mouth, he is in control of. I tell you right there, that's huge. when we don't allow anything to come out of our mouth that except it's by the Holy Ghost. When a man can bridle the tongue, he can bridle the whole body. He can rule his spirit. When you bridle the tongue, first you must bridle the thoughts. All this stuff comes running out of our mouth and we don't even know where it came from. Your thoughts zip through your head like and you don't even realize what's been going on because you're so accustomed to just listening to all kinds of stuff and thinking it's your thoughts and you thinking it, that you have allowed things to go on in your head that don't belong. We're to gird up the loins of our mind, to gird them up, to gird them up. We're to bring every thought captive unto the obedience of Christ Jesus. So our thoughts only think what Jesus is thinking. To his word, his obedience, thinking his thoughts. And then we'll speak his word. When we rule by the Spirit, our thought life will rule by the Spirit, our words. And there's a whole lot to it, but let me read this in Hosea. And I'm just going to start with verse 1. It's in chapter 6. Come and let us return unto the Lord. For he hath torn, and he will heal us. Isn't God good? Isn't he amazing? He is so amazing. He brings correction because he loves us. And this is the proof that we know that we're his, is because he's correcting us and he's leading us and guiding us in his direction. He's got out that shepherd's rod and that shepherd's hook. That, you know, the sheep's just going off its way and the sheep thinks it's just fine, but the shepherd's watching and there's a cliff there and that shepherd's going to reach that hook out and pull him back. And when the sheep's going over here the wrong way, the rod, it's going to comfort you. It's going to reel you right back in over here and bring you into the comfort of safety. Amen. You might be going, ouch, that hurt, but that's the comfort of safety because Father loves us so much. He's going to bring that correction, but he will heal us. He has smitten, and he will bind us up. After 2 days, we will revive. He will revive us. The third day, he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning, and he shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and the former rain upon the earth. I tell you, people, God's church needs to come and say, come and let us return unto the Lord. Because the church that calls on the name of Jesus Christ, that declares the name of Jesus, that still has the name of Jesus somewhere in them, has so departed from the faith, has so gone astray, that the church can't lead anybody to Jesus. There's so much conforming to this world, and there's not the transforming and the renewing of the mind going on. The mind is not focused on the things of heaven. The mind is busy. Even in this church, the mind is busy going about to and fro, doing the things that we think that we need to get done in this life. We don't have a mind that stayed on Jesus. And God's calling for a people that will have a mind that will follow the Spirit, that will be showing us the things of heaven. Minds that are stayed on Jesus. Amen. And Father would say to his church, get on your face, get on your face, and cry out to God. If your mind is busy about so many things, if your mind is running to and fro and doing all kinds of things and has not stayed on the Father and on what the Father's doing, get on your face and cry out to God. Get on your face and cry out to God for the change. He will bring the change if you're serious. And you won't find your mouth running off about blah, 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 and this and that and the other. Because your mind is being transformed because you're giving it over to the Lord. You're saying, I'm coming and I'm returning unto the Lord. My thought life is coming and returning unto the Lord. My thoughts are not going to be just thinking about this and that. His thoughts don't have fear. His thoughts don't have doubt and unbelief. His thoughts don't have envy. His thoughts don't have strife. His thoughts don't have evil speaking. His thoughts don't covet the things of this earth. His thoughts are not wandering off to see what everybody else is doing over at the movies because everybody, you know, they're saying how good this was or that was. His thoughts aren't there. His thoughts are, his kingdom come, his will be done in earth as it is in heaven. He's doing it in heaven. He fashioned the Ark of the Covenant in heaven. And then he took Moses up and he showed him the fashion of the Ark of the Covenant. And he said, now, Moses, I want you to make the likeness and the image of it upon earth. He wants the likeness of the image of his purpose and his plan that is in heaven, on earth, in every one of us. And if we had it, people, if we had that, we would be changing the world around us. We wouldn't be held back. We wouldn't be wondering about what to do. But we would be so caught up in what heaven's doing, we would see it on earth. It would be on earth. And I tell you, if you have to fast a day and then eat and then fast another day and then eat, find those places. If you got to work and you can't separate yourself, if you can't take vacation, people can take vacation to go and have fun and do these things and that and the other, but they don't find it fun to go and get before the Lord and say, Father, I want to be like you. Lord, I want to be on my face before you and I want to be like you. I want to be transformed completely into your image and your likeness. See, people don't want to put off what the world has put on the church. If you don't think that there is so much in the church that is conformed to the world, then think again. Think again. There are so many things. If we went back 200 years and we saw the church, if we saw the church that the Moravians had, those people that were putting off everything that was ungodly and separating themselves unto the Lord, were crying out to God in repentance, pressing in for revival, and they lived in a day where they did not have any kinds of distractions like we have. I mean, they were burning candles to even have light at nighttime. They didn't have the luxuries that we have, the things that distract us. You know, even the wealthy people back, you know, 150 years ago, 200 years ago, they wouldn't even burn their candles. They had to save them. That was the wealthy people. So then everybody went to bed when it was dark. You went to bed when the chickens went to bed. And you know what? You had a long night. And how many can sleep that long? There's not a lot of people that can sleep that long on a regular basis. I did have some raising of the hands. But the purpose is, you look at King David. He said, I arise in the night watches and I praise you. Because you get still before the Lord. There's a stillness there in the night season. There's a stillness there that he speaks to you, that he talks to you, that he shows you him. And in the fast, when you're separating yourself from food, it's not just separating yourself from food. People want to separate themselves from food and go on these fasts, and I'm fasting, but they just continue on with what they're doing. No, it's like a Sabbath. Like my mom said, they had Jewish neighbors when she was little, and they would get the little Gentile girls and boys. They'd yell at them, hey, can you come and turn on my light? Because they wouldn't even flip on a switch. A fast. To where you're not distracted. To where it's your knees, the word. Your knees, the word. Your knees, the word. That was Smith Wigglesworth. People are like, wow, the anointing, the power that Smith Wigglesworth had with God. Well, he stopped every 15 minutes, no matter where he was, and prayed. He'd be riding his buggy down the street. Probably needed to get things done. But 15 minutes of riding the buggy, he stopped the buggy. And then he prayed. And then he went on about his business. And 15 minutes later, he stopped and he prayed. You went to his house, people can tell you, there's witnesses. He'd be reading the word. Come here, let me show you this in the word. And then let's get down and pray. Okay, now let me show you this in the word. Now let's get down and pray. Let me show you this in the word and let's get down and pray. Let me show you this in the word and let's get down and pray. That's the life he lived. You know, it was Summerall, I think, that tried to bring a newspaper into his house when Smith invited him over, and he gets to the door. Smith comes to the door and he said, what's that under your arm? He said, well, it's just a newspaper. You throw that trash in the bushes. That's that's not coming in my house. Well, the news. It's the news. Smith Wigglesworth told the news before it happened. And he didn't read any papers. He told the news. He told what was going to happen because he was visiting with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God wants this kind of awakening. Not the 21st century awakening. The 21st century of idea of revival. But a totally turning from the things that the church has just gone on years after years after years and conformed and conformed and conformed and conformed. And we just go on living our life because this is the 21st century and we've got to hurry and get it all done. Don't you think that the enemy is the one that set this up to cause so much business, cause people running to and fro and continually got something they're wrapped up in that they can't stop and be alone with God? You can't get to bed early because there's this or that, and you stayed up and watched a TV show and it was really late, and you know, and so, and then you got to get up, and then there's no time to be still before the presence of the Lord. You're always trying to work the next thing into your busy, busy schedule. This isn't what God's called his church to do. He's called us to seek his face. And when he says, seek my face, we say, yeah, Lord, your face will I seek. Your face will I seek. This is revival. This is revival. Lord, your face will I seek. Not when I get a moment, but I'm giving it all to you. All to you. All to you, Lord Jesus. Putting away conversation, putting away the telephone. You don't answer, you don't go to your telephone. People fast texting me when I'm fasting. You're going to wait till tomorrow. Because I have audience before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, thank you, Jesus. This should be every day in our life. Every day. I tell you what, if you take a meal to fast every day. See, you know, some of you, you work to 5 o'clock. You know, or whatever. You have a long day. Take somewhere in there that if it's not a food fast, it's a prayer fast. That we're just seeking after God. And we're not continuing on. Because if you let this grow and let it get bigger, where there's the increase, you'll see the change. You'll see the change. You'll see the change. And I tell you what, when you're on those fasts, the beautiful things that Father gives you, the beautiful treasures out of heaven, the beautiful things that he speaks and he imparts to your spirit that you almost can't even share with anybody. And you know, to know that you've preached them and you've said them over and over again, and then Father says them to you in a different way than what you've read them and you've preached them, and all of a sudden you're illuminated and you're imparted with this new divine grace and understanding of the application of how he wants you to do it. And it's basically all follow the Holy Ghost. It all leads to following the Holy Ghost. It all leads to seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these things being added unto you, for which we can say and which we can quote, and we hear them. Like James says in 1:22, be not hearers of the word only, but be doers, deceiving your own selves. Not hearers only, because so many people come into the church and they hear and they go, it's good and this is what I want to do, but they don't apply it. They don't act upon it. They don't become a doer. They don't become a doer of these works and greater shall you do because I go to my Father. This is the impartation that he gave us. This is the mantle that he poured out on the church. When Elijah poured his out to Elisha, it was nothing compared to where Jesus threw his mantle upon the church. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost, the all-consuming fire of the Holy Ghost that leads us and guides us in all the truth of the Father, that is our protection, our comfort, our guide. Think of that. Job had that fiery protection around him, that wall built around him, but we got the Holy Ghost. Yes. We got the Holy Ghost protection around us. If we walk in him, if we walk in this way, if we do what he's called us to do, it will be serious. I tell you, church, if we will just hear, this is a year that we must hear like never before. We must get serious with God. We must cry out to God. And it's not about sacrifice, and it's not about giving of yourself to just accomplishing things in the ministry and doing more and getting busy. There's so many preachers out there that are having signs and wonders and miracles, but they'll stand before the Lord. This is a sad thing. They'll stand before the Lord and he'll say, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you." And they'll say, "Lord, Lord, didn't we do great miracles in your name? Didn't we cast out devils in your name? You never departed from iniquity." There's so many out there. There's so many out there. And Jesus will honor his name for the sake of the people. He will honor his name, but he sees the heart. God goes deep down past everything that nobody else can see. And he goes into the secret place and he sees the heart. And he knows if there's that fellowship and that covenant and that relationship with him. You may can fool man because you've understood and grabbed a hold of a principle in God that by the name of Jesus people are healed, and you may be gifted with that, but yet you get allured and caught up into the things of this life. And you continue on with the gift, but the power of God, the fire of God is not in your heart. It's a backslidden condition. But yet a condition that there was never that full surrender to God. That full, complete, total abandonment to God. And let's look right here in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Let a man so account us, verse 1, let a man so account us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards. I'm in the wrong verse. I'll find it here. Yeah, it's 2 Corinthians. And I said first, right? Therefore, seeing, we have this ministry. As we have received mercy, we faint not. But have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. Have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. Have renounced them. Have renounced them. When people come to Jesus and they just say a little prayer. I mean, a prayer is powerful when it comes from your heart, but when you're renouncing the world, renouncing it, that is a complete turning away from the world. That's not just a, you know, okay, I'm going to start this thing and, you know, try Jesus. That's these people that go, "Oh, no, I tried Jesus." And that's because somebody took them through, you know, all you got to do is say this prayer and then you're going to heaven. It isn't, no, it isn't say this prayer and then you're going to heaven. It's, I have decided to follow Jesus. It's, I've renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, the things that are of this world. I've renounced them. I was telling Pastor Mark, and I'll break in right here. I was telling Pastor Mark when Brother Joe and Becky Cruz were here, and Joe was talking about, and it just really hit me when Joe was talking about when he went to that church, and that lady took him through the 250 questions. And here he is, a Baptist boy, and he gets taken through these 250 questions, and when he does, the power of God falls upon him as he renounces every hidden thing of dishonesty, as he renounces those things in his life. The fire of the Holy Ghost comes on him and he gets baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm like, where is that 250 questions? I'm like, we need to take everybody through the 250 questions. He goes, let's get them. But seriously, whatever it takes people to move on and to realize that the former world is death. And we're separated from it. We have cut it off. And we're to be renewed. We're to be renewed. We're to be renewed in him. We're to turn from the world. The world is not to rule us and distract us. We're not to love the world. We're not to be conformed to the world. We're to be renewed by the things of the Spirit continually. Is this what you're thinking on? When I was a young girl, I'd be busy chatting with my dad as we're going down the road. And he goes, "Would you shut your mind down and get it on, Jesus?" He goes, "Because your mind is just running everywhere." He goes, you need to have Jesus in your mind and in your thoughts all the time. You need to be continually thinking about what the Spirit is thinking about. You need to be talking with the Father continually. Your thoughts are prayers. Are you thinking a prayer? Is your thoughts a prayer to heaven, or is your thought a prayer to hell? He goes, you're in a praying state in your thoughts. So when you're thinking out a plan to figure things out for yourself, to get it all even and straightened out, and how you're going to protect yourself, and how you're going to self-justify the state that you're in by pointing the finger. Self-justification always comes through pointing the finger. So if you're pointing the finger and you have a problem with someone, pointing the finger always brings self-justification, and self-justification always brings deception, and deception always brings hell. So when you're looking at somebody and you're seeing their problems, you are totally out of the realms of God. Because when you see the problems of someone, your heart should break and you should fall on your face and cry out for them. See, because God's loving. God wants to see everyone come to repentance. So your place is to cry out for them. You want to see a change? You cry out. And I tell you, I know sometimes I'll focus in on praying for somebody and it'll get worse. Because God's stirring things up. It'll get worse and you think, boy, we need to pull back, do something. You know, your mind might tell you need to just talk it out with them. Forget about talking it out with them. Stay right down there and let the Holy Ghost do what he's doing. You praying for them to get things right. The fire's up. They're squirming. Their nights get sleepless. It gets worse. Because you're bombarding heaven for them. You let God do his job, you do yours on your knees, not pointing your finger with your mouth. If you put away the pointing of the finger. My mom always said, you got one pointed out, you got three pointed back at you. So, you have no right to be saying anything. Because I tell you what, if you're pointing your finger, you in a mess. You're in a mess of yourself. The love of God imparted to you is going to be arms extended and wrapped around and loving on people and crying out to God continually for them. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. But renouncing, we have renounced, but we have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness or handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And then you can look at Paul, where he says over in Acts 24, I think it is. Yeah, 24:16. And herein I do exercise myself. Exercise myself. Now, if somebody seriously exercises, you know that that's a pressing in to go from one place to the next place and exercise. Because when you start out, you can only go so far. But if you continue on, you'll get stronger and stronger and stronger. So I exercise myself. I build myself up. I build myself up. I build myself up to have always a conscience void of offense towards God. That there's nothing in me that offends the Father. Not one thing. And toward all men, I will not offend anyone or be offended by anyone. I will not allow offense. Perfect peace have those that love his law. See, when we love his law, when we're so in love with him, we don't get offended. People can do things and we don't even have an idea that they do them. We don't even know it. They come to you and they apologize and you're like, I didn't even notice. Isn't that wonderful? Instead of being all offended, yeah, you did that to me and I was pretty mad, man. You ruined my day. You know how someone can ruin your day? Is you're not captivated by Jesus. You know how circumstances can mess you up and get you all upset is you're not captivated by Jesus. That's it. Because when you're captivated by Jesus, you find all your fulfillment in Him, and you don't find that fulfillment in anyone else or things. Things don't fulfill you. You don't have to have the next pretty, most in style thing. You don't have to have it. You can just trust the Lord to dress you like He wants to, or give you what you need, and be happy with what you got, and be thankful for what you got. And a lot of times you might have what you have because you weren't thankful. But don't go seeking after the things that the Gentiles seek after. Don't go seeking after this life. Seek Him. Seek the kingdom. And you'll find all your fulfillment. You'll be happy. Everybody else around you can be sad and sorrowful, and you'll be happy in every situation. You'll find yourself counting it all joy. Counting it all joy. Paul didn't get mad at the people when he was left dead, when they thought he was dead after they stoned him. He just got up and he went to preach to the next place. And he came back around, because the first time he went to Ephesus, it wasn't a totally good turnout. They got a start. They sowed, they plowed, they planted. But by the time Paul got done going through Ephesus, powerful church established, turned things upside down. That whole region was turned upside down, because Paul didn't give up and he didn't chicken out. When you've been stoned and left for dead, you really want to feel like God's not calling you back to that area. That's a time that you want to say, I'm shaking the dust off of my feet. They would not hear the word. And I will not return. But he kept pounding on that door. And he took the beatings and the stonings. And like Stephen, when you're speaking by the Spirit, they cannot resist the Word of God. They can't stand it. They can't stand against it. They cannot resist it. Because it's all power and all authority. And it doesn't matter what they do to this body. It matters that you're obedient and you stand before Him. But first, we got to deal with the church coming out of the world before we can go on to the former and the latter rain, the moving, the outpouring. Oh God, we cry out for revival. But if we just draw that circle in the room like Pastor Mark's been talking about and get revival on the inside of us till when people see us, they don't know us. Because we allow God to conform us in His image and His likeness, and it ain't going to look like us. Oh God, it's not going to look like us anymore. I tell you, thinking about the people that I know and I love, and John Ward, I tell you, I almost don't even want to go there, but John Ward, that man, I so dearly love John. I didn't have much to do with John before he got saved. Talked to him just a little bit before I was kind of scared of him, before he got saved. But I tell you what, after that man got saved, you're talking about a man that loved God, and just his face would shine with the glory of God. And he was just telling me New Year's Eve, he just told me, because I begged him for years, John, you got to come. John, you got to come to the abiding place. John, you got to come. John, you got to come. And, last year I told him, I said, the time is now, John. The time is now. You must come. And so he called, I'm talking to him on the phone. He said, well, looks like I'm coming out there. And I was like so elated and so excited. But thinking of John and the man John was, you know what I loved about John? John talked about Jesus all the time. John loved Jesus so much that the love of God emanated out of him. John never felt like he was a person that was unapproachable, but he was like Jesus in "Suffer all the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God." You never felt like you couldn't approach John. Anybody. I mean, I was around John a lot, and anybody could come up to John. He loved on everybody. He made sure he hugged everybody. I mean, the most kind, loving, precious person. And all he did was talk about Jesus. And he was always in the mode of, okay, God, I'm here. Now what are you doing? I'm available. He was always available. In a restaurant, literally, a man died. Threw up blood, projectile blood across the room. Everybody fled the restaurant except John. And John just waits. Okay, God, now what do you want me to do? And he waited a few minutes, and the nurses are over there doing all they could do, and basically they couldn't find a pulse, and the man was dead, and John says, okay, God, now it's time. You know, he heard, now it's my turn. John walked up behind the man, and he laid his hands on the man, and he prayed for him just real softly, and the guy wakes up. This was John. The guy wakes up. He rose the man from the dead. The guy was dead. I mean, he projectile blood across the room. The nurses said, you know, there's no life. John was just waiting on what God was going to tell him to do when his part was. And I know when John got to heaven, when John entered into glory, I can't even believe I'm saying this. This isn't even real. But I know when he went into the presence of the one he loved, he was so captivated. And I begged Father to send him back. Because I'm like, Lord, there's just so few of men and women like John on the face of the earth. But I think John's will to stay there was stronger than our will to have him come back. And I John Luke said, he came running into the room this afternoon about 3:00, and he said, I think John Ward's going to come visit us today. They've been praying and interceding together. Matter of fact, 2 days ago when they were down praying, Kristen had the kids together, Mike and John Luke and Ethan all together praying. He hears a knock at the door. And he goes, that's John Ward. And I mean, John Luke knows who John Ward is. When somebody takes you and puts you on their heavy equipment and they take dirt with that big scoop and they lift it up and then they let you turn that little thing, you don't forget who John Ward is. And they ride you around, and you get to spin around that little top thing and all the stuff. You know, because this is John. Little kid, y'all come over here. I want to show y'all something. Now y'all get up in this. And their eyes are this big. You know, and you have to lift them up into this thing. And they've only seen these little bitty deals like this. They've never seen anything that's like massive. And all over the place and running on the dirt with all, you know, so he knows who John Ward is. So he goes, John Ward's at the door. And he goes and opened the door, and it wasn't John Ward. He said to the person at the door, John Ward's coming to our church on Sunday. I'm like, well, I'm going to have to tell him that as soon as he gets up. But, you know, the grave couldn't hold Jesus. So I don't know what God's going to do. I'm still believing. But Pastor Mark did commit his body to the grave unto the resurrection of the dead. Hallelujah, that we know that is our hope. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Oh, let's just look at that just because, I don't know. It's getting off of that the message, but I, you know, went over here on John Ward, and so, hallelujah. Listen to this. For the 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. But we'll start in verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not even as others. Woo! Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. That you sorrow not as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died, see, if you're in Jesus, then you know you're going to see your loved one that's already gone over there. Or you know that no matter what happens on this earth and who dies and what goes on, and if your family was to get separated in all kinds of chaos or whatever, everybody's got Jesus and you're going to all meet. You're going to all meet in in the heaven. You're all going to see Jesus one day. It's all, you're going to all come together. And that circle, as my mother used to always sing, that circle, it won't be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by. It's going to be a reunion in heaven. You're going to see all your loved ones there. Hallelujah. For if we believe that Jesus died and that he rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Hallelujah. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Are you ready to be comforted? That any moment, John could be getting up and everybody else that's in Christ Jesus getting up out of that grave. I put this on my mother's tombstone. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, I put that on there because I want everybody to know. I wanted everybody to go and look that up because she's waiting for that trumpet to sound. And I'm going to meet her one day in the air. Hallelujah. I'm going to meet her again. But greater than that, I'm going to meet Jesus. I'm going to be forever with the Lord one day. Hallelujah. And we want to see everyone be there with the Lord. And God is so good, and he's so merciful, and he's calling us over to this realm of glory with him. But we can't live our own life. We can't do our own thing. And we can't think that we're going to get there our own way. God is not interested in Cain's offering. But he did tell Cain, he broke it down into pieces for Cain. He says, Cain, you know what the right offering is. And if you do the right thing, you'll be accepted. But why are you upset? You did the wrong thing. But Cain had a religious, self-righteous, self-justified attitude. And he goes, why is he getting blessed and I'm not? Instead of just repenting and saying, Lord, you're right, I did it wrong. Because Cain knew what to bring. But he decided, he made up his mind that his offering was good enough. He didn't have to come God's way. This is what he did. Yeah, Abel's bringing something out of his herd because that's what Abel does. Is he leads sheep. I till the ground and I raise food, and so I'm bringing food. Why would my offering not be accepted? His own way. Man continually wants to do it their own way. We have that in our face every day. The enemy's going over here. And we should not be able to hear his voice as God's people. As God's people, we should not even be able to hear his voice because our minds and our thoughts should so be so wrapped up in Jesus that when he whispers, we cannot hear. But if we'll do just exactly what James said in James chapter 1, verse 22, to be doers of the word, when we find ourselves doing the word, doing everything he's called us to do, doing, acting upon it. If we will set the goal, if we'll set the mark, as he said, he promised that we would do these works and greater works than he did. And not wait till we're 90 years old, but to just participate with the Holy Spirit. The deal is we need to shut these things off that are distractions. And there's too many in this world. We've got iPhones, iPads, telephones, TVs, movies, and the next one coming out. And why in the world would God's people ever want to see what was created by an ungodly person? Out of their imaginations. Where did their imaginations come from? What imaginations did they have? Were they heavenly? Is it pointing you to Jesus? I remember when my Aunt Chris was like 90 years old, she came to visit us. And my sister wanted her to see a movie. And she said, what movie do you want me to see? And she goes, oh, it's just a movie about something, you know, just a nice, clean movie. She goes, is it going to help me get to heaven? She said, my thoughts are on how can I get to heaven. And I don't want anything that's a distraction. If it's not going to help me get to heaven, I don't want your nonsense. And my sister felt like about that big. But you know what? That was truth imparted. I kept that. I kept those words. If it's not going to help me get to heaven, do I need it? I need to be over here. And like Pastor Mark was saying, by the time that they were 13 years old, they knew the first five books of the law, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. They sang them. They learned in the school. They would go in, the Jewish kids, they would sing the books of the law, and that's how they learned them. And they hid it in their heart. And I was explaining to my grandkids the other day, you know, how important it is to have the Word of God hidden in your heart. I said, you know, I'm in eighth grade, and we're studying on evolution. And I was skipping that chapter. I wasn't reading it. I didn't care. I didn't care what. I didn't care anything about it. It was against everything I believed. I knew that. And I wasn't going to do it. So the teacher figured that out somehow. And never called on me for anything, but he called on me to say, to ask me how creation, how the earth came in, creation came into existence, you know, and he wanted the big bang answer. And I said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light. I didn't say it quite like that, because there was about 30 kids in the room. But I held to it. And he said, I did not ask you for what your belief was. I want to know what your assignment is, and I want the right answer now. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light. And he said, I'm telling you, you better give the right answer now. Textbook answer, or you're getting paddled. We got paddled. I don't know. You know, this is Mississippi. Mississippi and Texas, you come under authority. And they had this big board about like this with a handle on it. And they hit hard. And I think that this was the second time I got paddled in school ever. But so he said, I want the right answer now. And I said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters and said, let there be light. And he goes, you know, and everybody's booing me, everybody in the class, every time. They're booing. Oh, boo, 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 you know, and all of this stuff, you know, kids in eighth grade, idiots at that age. And one of the most popular girls in school, she stands up, she goes, she's a little Baptist girl, and she goes, I know what she's saying, it's true. And then everybody's looking at her going, oh, wow, it's true? But I still had to go out and get my paddling, even though. So I had to go out and grab my ankles, and he paddled me with the board. And, you know, I came back in, but my answer didn't change. We got to know the Word of God, because man is going to try to convince us of something else. The world will try to convince us of something else. But if the Word of God is hidden in our heart, it doesn't matter what we're threatened with. I was persecuted for righteousness' sake. I got a few paddles for righteousness' sake, and that's just the beginning. As we stand up in this day and this hour, there's going to be resistance. We must know the Word of God. It must be hidden in us, and we must give our time to it. You know, what do our kids know? What are they fellowshipping with? Are you preparing them for their eternity? Are you preparing them for their destiny? Are you preparing them for the days that are ahead? The days that our kids, my grandchildren, are facing are troublesome times. And we need to be preparing them with all diligence. And if we're busy everywhere else, but where God has called us to be, how are we going to be preparing them? And if we are going back to those things that we've renounced in any way, realizing that we open up a spiritual door that floods to our children, especially the men. Men are the first one responsible to stand before God. Whatever, and I'm going to say this because whatever you allow in your spirit goes to your children. And it's so imperative that you break these things off, that you break them off. Thank God when there is a husband that is not saved, an ungodly man that will not turn to God, the prayer of the woman, the righteousness of the woman covers the children, and she can break it off. But realize the battle. The woman's got to break it if the man doesn't take his responsibility, if the man abdicates his responsibility as the leader of the home, he puts it on the woman's shoulder, and don't complain. You know, men are real good about, I'm the boss of this house, but are you a real good leader in the things of the kingdom? Because if you're not, you're abdicating to the wife. And don't come whining when she's charging. But thank God for that. But there's so much in this of breaking this stuff off. When this stuff has gone on, you have to have it broken off. And then you need just looking in that. We were over here in James. Let's go back over here to James. There's some keys over here. Renouncing the hidden things of dishonesty. James 5:13. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing songs. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. See, the church, the body of Christ, that's a whole nother subject that I just really feel like we need to talk more about. The church, the body, the church. Any among you? Do you hear that? Any among you? Among who? Among the church. The hand, the foot, the finger, gifts imparted differently as the Holy Spirit makes the decision to impart them to us, but all come together as one body. Everybody's not the eye, everybody's not the head, everybody's not the same part, but every gift is important in the body, in the local body, in the church that we're supposed to be hooked up with. Nobody can be out there dangling on their own. If you've got a foot out there just stomping around on its own, anybody sees you, they're going to run. Because that's just scary. Run or have authority to take dominion over you and tell you to get over in the local body where you need to be. Because really, if you're not submitted, you've got to be submitted to someone. You've got to be under authority. And there's the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, to bring us all into that place of perfection in God, to bring us all into the maturity. Anyway, back over here. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders. Make sure you have elders. Because I don't care who you are. There's an opportunity, there's a chance that you could get sick. You bind it in Jesus' name. I mean, I don't even want to say that, Father, because in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. But I tell you what, I'm learning to take that authority over, I found out that I do not burn doesn't work over I do not whatever else. I have to step in and take that authority. In each area, I do not allow these things in me. I will not have them. I don't want sickness. Sickness and sin are Siamese twins from hell, and both of them come from the same place, and I don't want any of them in my life. Neither one of them. They don't belong here. I am the temple of the living God, and I'm the one that's supposed to keep this temple, and I'm the only one that's going to stand before God for how I kept the temple. Nobody's going to stand before God for me, and nobody's going to stand before God for you. Pastor Mark will stand and give an account for the church because that's the place of the pastor. But we still have to stand there alone before God. And are you ready? Are you ready for the trumpet to sound? And at any moment you go up right before him and give an account for the deeds in your body. Give an account for the way that you're living your life. Give an account for your conversation. Give an account for your thoughts. Give an account for what you've done with your time. Give an account for those people that you have brought to Jesus. Give an account for the fruit of your life, the fruit of the Holy Ghost moving and operating and leading you and guiding you into what the Father's doing. And let them pray over them, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he hath committed any sin, they shall be forgiven him. The goodness of God. Just, you sin, you got sick, you got in the situation, you call for the elders of church, they pray over you. If you sin, you're forgiven. The goodness of God. Oh, he's so good. He's so good. But we don't want to walk on that grace of God. We don't want to walk on that. And then the next one. Confess your faults one to another. Pray one for another that you may be healed. Confessing your faults. And these things that would be things that people repeatedly do and that they don't conquer in their life. That if you come back to those things that you have renounced and you allow those things in your life in any way, sin, ungodliness, you want to deal with it. You want to confess that. You want to get that out. You want to confess your faults one to another so somebody can lay their hands on you and pray for you, because the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And so you want to get that thing broken off of your life. If there's a repetitive thing, fast and pray, take dominion, cry out to God, repent. I mean, if you will fast and pray, it will come to an end at that place where you confess it. You come to that place of being humble and broken, and you confess it, and you have someone lay their hands on you and pray for you and break that thing off of you that it doesn't have an access. There needs to be a breaking off of it. If you've gone back to something, do you understand that? You hear that. It has to be broken. You need it broken off of you. Because you're repenting before the Lord, but you're not getting serious to where you're going after the breaking of the thing. And then as, you know, you get into this and you look at the things that are imparted to you from your parents. Has anyone ever heard of, I don't ever want to treat my children like my dad or like my mother treated me? Or how I saw Aunt so-and-so treat her child. But then you find yourself acting upon that. Is that DNA? Is that, you know, just a natural, you know, color of the skin or what color your eyes are or if your hair is curly or straight? That's a spiritual thing. It's a spiritual thing. And if you leave it alone and you don't deal with your household, you don't deal with your children, those, and break that stuff in Jesus' name, it'll be inherited to them. You want to break it off your life. You want to confess that whole thing in your life. And say, okay, Lord, I don't want this business going on in my life. I break it in Jesus' name. If your mom did something to you and you find yourself doing it to your child and you hated it done to you, when you came to Christ, you should have renounced that. But I understand that people don't realize that. And so those things that were imparted reoccur, and it goes from generation to generation to generation. You want to deal with it. You want to deal with those traits that are in the family. And it's getting on your face and going, no, this is wrong. This is not God. This action, this attitude. You know, I can think of one thing. You know, I know people that I've heard that would take their kids and throw them down the stairs. You know, they get mad at them, take their kid, throw them down the stairs. Plop, 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 down the stairs. And bam, land on the end of the steps. And, well, that's what my dad did to me when he was disciplining me. He threw me down the stairs. You know, and kids not listening, pick them up, 10 years old, throw them down the stairs. You know, or people punching their kids because they're angry. What is that? Discipline isn't you reacting and screaming, yelling, smacking. Discipline is like God. And what does he do? What does he do? He's a shepherd. And his rod and his staff, they do comfort me. They bring us back in. But God is good and he's merciful and he's tender. The day of wrath is laid up. If you're a sheep, he's correcting, he's bringing you in. We as people of God want to have that same kind of thing. And most of the time, if you sit down with your child and you just stop your business and running to and fro and just say, look, we're going to reel this in and we're going to bring this in and we're going to deal with this stuff. And this isn't going to be in the house. And you get into the face of your child and you start correcting them. A lot of times the child will break. And especially if you've been praying for the breaking and you've been pressing in the spirit and praying that these things be broken, when you realize that the actions of your children are a lot of times the things that were never broken off of you and came from your parents, which came from their parents. A hardened harshness. There was a hardened harshness in the church that God didn't intend to be when he brought forth his love through his son, Jesus Christ. But he means for a firmness. He means for discipline. And I'm not saying he doesn't, and we don't want any humanism. See, there's so much humanism passed down. Man's way of thinking of how we should do it. So we don't want either side. We want God's way. You know, and in Deuteronomy chapter 20, I think it's verse 16, it talks about if your son is stubborn and rebellious, and he will not listen to the correction of his father, and he will not listen to the correction of his mother, you were to take that son and you were to bring him to the elders of the area that you're in. See, the church. You've got to always have those people around you. To bring them to the elders. And you tell it to the elders, and they're to take him and all the people and to stone him that you may put evil out from among you. And it's over and over again, God's laws. Humanism hates God's way. But it's that you may put evil. See, the law was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. And Christ cleansed us. He washed us. He purified us. And now through prayer, you can put evil out from among you. You can confess and forsake your sin. Confess and forsake it and be healed. And put evil out from among you. Or you can allow deception to grow worse and worse, because if you're careless with what goes on in your life, if you're careless with your life, if you're careless with what you allow, you will come under deception. And the church has been under deception, and we've inherited what our forefathers have passed down. And so if you look, such a change in the things that were allowed among the body of Christ and in the church. Like Pastor Mark says, rank sinners had more reverence than what Christians do today, because we've been passed down what the world dished out that the church took in. The world dished out. You can go back and study the rebellion of the world after the revivals of 1906. 1920, what happened? You see a complete, you see, and I don't know why I'm over here, but you see where the blues music became popular. And as people began to go and listen to that blues music, there was a worship in it. And then what came after that? You think about it. Go study it out. What came after that? Before that, what is hooked up with music? Immorality. And what's hooked up with immorality? Shaming yourself. You put it together. I don't want to be a clothesline preacher, but let me ask you, where was the length of the clothing before the flappers? You deal with it. You have your relationship with God. I'm gonna have mine. But it's good to look back in history to see what was there. It's good to look right here in the Word of God and know and understand what it says. You can look at Ham, and we could say a lot about it, but the fact is he looked upon his father's nakedness, and because he did, he was cursed. And you can say a whole lot about that, but the fact is, his two brothers walked backwards with the covering, and they laid the covering over their father. And so what? That's just a whole mess, because how Noah ended up in that situation. But, you know, then again, we can talk about alcohol. What does it do? Brought a curse on his son. It never does anything good. You can say what you want to. It never does anything good. It never brings forth life. It opens up a spiritual realm, and it's not the Holy Spirit. And that's why he says, be not drunk with wine. Be not intoxicated with wine. Which is debauchery. Which is a turning from the presence of the Lord and not being satisfied with the Holy Spirit. Not saying that the Holy Spirit is all we need, but saying that we need something else to come and help us relax and get our thoughts over into immoral thinking. Because alcohol takes your thoughts over into immoral thinking. And you say, how do you know? By the Spirit, because I never had any. Because I made a vow as a little girl. My dad convinced me. I think I'm the only one of the six children that he convinced to make this vow. But I made a vow as a little girl, and I understood, and he took me through the principles that it was better not to make a vow before God than to make a vow and break it. So I made a vow as a little girl that I would not drink wine, that I would take, you know, a vow like the Nazarites did, not the complete Nazarite vow, but a vow that I would never drink alcohol. And so, you know, because when the enemy tries to mess with the kids when they hit the 14, 15 years old. He's got all this allure, 16, 17, 18, to try to pull them away. And so, you know, my dad just felt like if we take that vow, it would help us never to get into more trouble, because he understood the principle of where those things can take you. They can lead you into more and more, they do lead you into more and more immorality, because they open up the spiritual realm, and it's not the holy spiritual realm, it's the darkness. And why, when we have all the light, would the church want to turn to the darkness? Oh, God, have mercy. Oh, God, have mercy. And we've got to have these things in us, engrafted in us. And the only way we're going to get them there is being on our face before God and getting real with God and separating ourselves to the Father and putting His Word, hiding His Word in our heart that we might not sin against Him. Amen. And I know this is Old Testament, but I love what King David said in Psalms 19. And I think about this scripture a lot. And then you can take it into the New Testament, and we can go on. We could go on to the entire topic of be not deceived. Deceiving your own selves and being not deceived. And not allowing deception, because these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. I don't care how you dress them up. I don't care how you bring them into a church and you say it's okay and there's a bunch of grace to cover it. This word of God says they will not inherit the kingdom of God. And one of the biggest things that you need to take is the disobedience from the beginning, because that is what brings you into the rest of it. Disobedience. When you have somebody over you in the Lord and you submit yourself to them and you're not off over doing your own thing, you have protection on you so you don't get over into more disobedience. God does not want your sacrifice. He wants your obedience. It's just like people can come and they can give Him the offering, but they go out and they don't obey the word of the Lord. They don't even know it to obey it. I've seen people sit in church for 10, 15 years. And one time I was ministering in the Old Testament, and they're like, wow, you ministered out of the Old Testament. You know, and I'm like, yeah. I'm like, it's part of the word. I mean, you know, Paul and Peter and everybody studied the Old Testament. Oh, really? I've never read the Old Testament. I'm like, oh, my goodness. And the sad thing was is they came to this church. I was pretty blown away. But I'm like, do they listen? Mercy, Father. But I love how David was he was so humble before God. He was a man that walked with God in humility, so humble before the Lord. He broke at anything the Father said. His heart was so tender. He didn't sit in church and go, you know, what time is it? He said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. For they'll be singing and dancing, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed. Well, that's a song. But anyway, added on to other things that he said, all mixed together. Jesus. But he loved the presence of the Lord. And his heart was always tender towards God. He made mistakes, but he said, I'm the man. I'm the man. And was willing to be broken and contrite and just fall on his face before God and repent. Now I'm going to tell you, you know, I got into confessing your faults one to another and let them pray for you and be healed. You know, my husband is the head of us, you know. He's the head of our family. So I go to my head, and I continually, if I feel like I've done something wrong, I confess to my husband. And when, you know, the Lord's dealt with me about things, and I get on my face and I fast. And I'm like, Lord, I don't want anything that doesn't please you anyway. And I mean, I'm there all day. I want the breakthrough. I want to be done with the thing. And I confess it, and I have my husband pray over me. And you know, this is my practice. This is what I do. Because I want to look at the Word of God diligently, and I want to do what it says. So I can move on and do more in God. But more than that, I just want to know Jesus. I want to know Jesus. And I want to love him like he loves me, even though Pastor Mark says we can't. I still want to. I want to love him like he loves me. And I tell you what, for that to be my goal in life, we'll get somewhere. When our focus is on Jesus, Lord, I don't want to do anything that displeases you. Lord, because I love you so much. I thank you. I really count it dear, the salvation that he's given me. He came and he took my place. He came and he took my place so I didn't have to go to eternal hell. He took my place. His love for me, how great. But anyway, in Psalms 19, let's read before he says this. I'm going to back up. The law of the Lord is perfect. His word is perfect, converting the soul. The statutes of the Lord are right, and they're righteous altogether. And I better read it because I'm saying it wrong. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimonies of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. And the commandments of the Lord are pure, enlightening the eye. The fear of the Lord is clean. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil in every evil way. And when you hate it, you turn from it and you don't participate in it. This is how you know that you have the fear of the Lord in you. You hate evil and you don't participate. This is how that you know that you're in him and he's in you, because you hate evil and you don't participate. You love what God loves. You love his law. You love his righteousness. You love his truth. Enduring forever. And I am reading out of the Old Testament, but if you've got a couple of hours, we can take you completely through the New Testament and we can show you all of this, because it's there. Just for those that might be wondering why I'm reading out of the Old Testament. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than the honey and the honeycomb. Do you feel that way about the Lord's word? Yes. Is it really sweet to you, so sweet to you that you just cannot make it without his word? Because you know that it's going to impart to you his goodness. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them is great reward. Great reward, eternal reward. Hallelujah. And I tell you, the principal thing in keeping the law of the Lord is the number one commandment that he gave us before he left. Love your neighbor as I have loved you. Walk in that love that I've given you by the Holy Spirit. Walk in this love and then let everything else follow under the love. But the principle, number one thing, is love. And who is your neighbor? God made that clear to us, didn't he? It wasn't the person that lived next door only. It was whoever we saw in need. I mean, God is so about us doing the right thing. He so laid it out. You know, if you read in Deuteronomy chapter 20 and 21 and 22 and 23 and 24, it's all laid out. If your neighbor's ox gets out and you see the ox wandering down the street, you don't walk past it, you go get his ox. And if you know whose ox it is, you take it back to him. And if you don't know whose ox it is, you bring it to your house until your neighbor comes looking for the ox. You don't know the neighbor. And you still go get his ox. You know, you don't pass by, you know, you go, oh, there's John's ox out. He better come get that thing. God says you're responsible to get his ox. God, look at that. Look at that, because that's how Father is with you. He's getting your ox. He's providing your needs. He's taking care of you. He wants us to be like our Father in heaven. His goodness. Now I'll get to the scriptures that I wanted to read. Verse 12. Who can understand his arrows? Cleanse me. Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgressions. Keep me, Lord. And that's how Father is. When you step out to go do something, I mean, you have to. It is against everything that God has given you once He's washed you in His blood. Once you're washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, for you to step out and to do sin is so against Him. He's pulling you back. And then those thoughts, see that, the imperativeness of keeping your thoughts, because that is where those secret presumptuous sins can start if you're not having your mind girded up with truth continually and praying in the Holy Ghost. If you step over here and get into the frustration of your busyness because you haven't been over here in the secret place, those things can run loose and wild. There's so much girding up we need to do. And I'm telling you, people, if you're sitting here and you think you've got it all girded up, I'm going to tell you, don't deceive yourself. But are we supposed to in our walk with God? Absolutely. Absolutely. It is our walk with God, and God is calling us to get serious and to get on our face and to cry out to Him. I'm asking Him to show me. Show me, Father. 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 Show me, Lord. I'm continually at this place with God. If there's anything that doesn't please You, show me what I can do to be more like You. I got a dream last night. And I'm like, I haven't even thought of anything to do with that in so long. And the Lord just gave me some instructions of how to bring some healing and how I could be the key in bringing healing. But I'm continually, as I'm going to bed, as I'm getting up, as I'm on my face praying, as I'm fasting, as I'm seeking God, show me, Father. Show me, Father. And I think of these scriptures, and I take them over there to where Paul exercised himself. He gave himself that he would have no offense towards God. No offense towards God. And we want to give ourselves to not be careless, just running rampant, doing whatever we need to get done. We've just got to do it all and get it done. But we want to be focused on how we can be the servant of the Most High God continually, being obedient to Him. We thank You, Lord Jesus. We thank You, Jesus, for Your love and Your kindness and Your mercy. I tell you, people, God in His love and His mercy, He's crying out to a church that will stand up and be His church, His representative in the earth today. And I will say that this is the best church I know of anywhere on the face of the earth. But I would say Father's calling us to step it up, to step it up, to really get into His Word and look at it and mirror yourself in the Word of God and let Him work His perfect work on the inside of us, that we have no offense towards God or man. Yeah. And we are not offended. No offense and not offended, but surrendered and just in love with Jesus. Just so in love with Jesus. Our hearts so panting after the things of the kingdom. Thank You, Lord Jesus. And if anybody wants to come forward and have prayer or just come before the Father right now, if God's touched you with what He's been speaking and you would like prayer, we want you to come right now and get prayed for. And just say, here I am, Lord. And if there's people up in the nursery, somebody help them so they can come for prayer. And the kids upstairs and the 3 to 5 year olds, I'm always thrilled to see the little kids just come into the altar service where they can get touched by the power and the presence of God. And it's good for us to have the altar services up there with them, but down here, it's very good for your kids to teach them to come to the Father, to just come to the presence of the Lord. And then you just reach to heaven and say, Father, here I am. Father, I'm not going to go back and forth. I'm not going to be tossed to and fro with everything that is around me. I'm not going to be unstable. But Father, I'm going to walk after You, Lord Jesus. I just surrender myself to You. Lord, I just thank You, Father, that You're teaching me to go deeper in the realms of Your presence and the realms of Your anointing. And then You're all I want. You're all I see. You're all I need, Lord Jesus. Father. Father, teach me how, Father, to continually gird up the loins of my mind, Father, and continually be in a place of worship and praise and prayer in Your presence, God. We praise You, Lord Jesus. We praise You, Lord Jesus. You just talk to the Father. Every one of you, just talk to the Father. You just tell Him. You tell Him what's on your heart. You talk to Him. Father, here I am. Lord Jesus, I thank you, Father, that you're teaching me, Father, to walk in your paths of righteousness. Father, you're leading me and you're guiding me into all of your truth, Father. I thank you, Father God, that you have a people that are staying over here in the realms of your presence. And Father, we're learning and we're taking a hold of your word and things that you speak. We're taking a hold of it. And Father, we're applying it and we're not going to just be hearers, but we're going to be doers of your word. We're going to give ourselves, Father. We're going to give ourselves, Father, to seeing the former and the latter reign. Because we separate ourselves from all the things that are in this world that the church has allowed themselves to be conformed to. And Father, we will no longer be conformed to this world. Father, we will not allow it. Father, and you show us each and every one, Father, in visions and in dreams. Father, as we seek your face, as we cry out to you, Father, you show us and you teach us your ways, O God. You lead us, O God, in your paths of righteousness. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Lift your hands in the name of Jesus. Father, the anointing of heaven. The anointing of heaven. The anointing of heaven. In Jesus' name. The glory of heaven in Jesus' name. Father, break the yokes. Break the yokes and bring the change. Break the yokes, Father, off your people and bring the change, Lord Jesus. Lord. Father God, that we seek you with our whole heart, and we hold nothing found, back.
I will call upon him while he's near. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near.
Father, your anointing.
I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him.
Anything that doesn't please you, Lord Jesus, the change in the family, the Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire, Father, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, the Holy Ghost and fire, in the name of Jesus.
I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon while he's near.
In Jesus' name.
Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. My refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, the shelter from the storm.
You're conforming and
you're
bashing.
My refuge, my sanctuary,
into your life and into your image, Father, dwelling
place, shelter from the storm. You're my refuge,
Father, in the name of Jesus.
My sanctuary, my dwelling place. My shelter from the storm.
Father, we break off all the lies and the deception and the discouragement that's come out against
my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. And I will seek the Lord while he may be found.
In Jesus' name.
I will call
in the name
upon
of Jesus.
While he's near.
You're broken in Jesus' name. Fresh
yes,
fire.
I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near.
Fire the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name. Fire the
yes,
Holy Ghost.
I will seek the
fresh
Lord.
Fresh fire the Holy Ghost.
While
fire,
he may
fresh
be
fire,
found,
Jesus,
I will call upon
him thank you, Lord. Fresh fire, the Holy Ghost. Fresh fire, the Holy Ghost. Fresh fire, Lord.
My refuge.
In Jesus' name. Father, we
my
thank
sanctuary.
You. Fire. Fresh fire. Fresh fire, Father.
My Jesus. Dwelling place.
Fresh fire. In the name
my
of Jesus.
My shelter from the storm.
Yeah.
You're my refuge.
Fire, the Holy Ghost. Fire, the Holy Ghost.
My sanctuary.
Fire, the Holy Ghost.
My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge. My sanctuary,
fire.
My dwelling place,
we thank you, Jesus.
My shelter from the storm.
Fire, Holy Ghost.
You're my refuge.
Fire, the Holy Ghost. The fire of the Holy Ghost.
Woo!
Taylor,
my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm.
Fire, the Holy Ghost, right here. The fire, the
but you're my refuge.
Father, I thank you for Patricia, Father, standing.
My sanctuary.
Standing.
My dwelling place. My shelter from the storm.
Standing, Father, for her family.
But you're my refuge.
I thank you, Jesus, for a mom.
My sanctuary.
The fight's a good fight of faith, Lord.
My dwelling place. My shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge. My sanctuary. My dwelling place. My shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge. My sanctuary. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. And I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. For you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. And I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. For you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Thank you. seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. For you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Thank you. seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. You are my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. But you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Thank you.